The Leadership Engine by Noel Tichy with Eli Cohen. In an 18-month period, shortly before he became CEO of PepsiCo in early 1996, Roger Enrico spent nearly a third of his time at his house in the Cayman Islands. This may seem like a pretty unusual way for the vice chairman of a multi-billion-dollar company based in Purchase, New York, to do his job. But his job is exactly what Roger Enrico is doing. He was doing it extremely well. In this remote, off-site setting, away from the daily demands of making potato chips, selling sodas, and resolving assorted day-to-day problems, Enrico was preparing PepsiCo to survive and thrive into the 21st century. He was running his own personal war college to develop a new generation of leaders for PepsiCo. In sessions running from early in the morning until late at night, Enrico would lead 9 executives at a time through 5 days of action learning. As a vehicle for learning, he had each student take on a Grow the Business project that would have a significant dollar impact on the company. He would coach them on developing a stretch dream objective and an implementation effort, and then send them out to work on their projects. Several months later, they would return for a 3-day session to review their progress. In the meantime, Enrico would start another class. As a result, PepsiCo has nearly 100 much better developed leaders who not only have implemented some great business ideas for PepsiCo, but are now following Enrico's example and developing other leaders. In the past decade, a number of corporate giants have fallen on their faces. GM, Apple, Kodak, Westinghouse, AT&T, and American Express are some of the more prominent ones. Kmart, U.S. Air, Philips Electronics, Digital Equipment, several Japanese banks, and lots more could be added to the list. These former titans of commerce have gotten out of step with their customers, watched unhappy investors flee, and cut back operations as their businesses have crumbled. They have become, to put it bluntly, losers. It would be easy to blame these companies' woes on the changing global marketplace and on the demands of operating in a new business environment where all the rules of competition have changed. But the truth is that during the same period, a group of clear winners has emerged as well. While Westinghouse was struggling, GE has climbed from one success to another. While IBM rearranged the deck chairs on the Titanic, Compaq Computer recovered from its own earlier stumbles and surged to the forefront. And entrepreneurial upstarts, such as Starbucks and Staples, have simply created entirely new, highly successful organizations. There's something going on in the winning companies that sets them apart from the losers. In my 25 years as an organizational psychologist and a management consultant, I've seen lots of troubled companies up close. From the inside. I've also worked with a number of winning companies, including General Electric, where I worked full-time as head of leadership development at its Crotonville Executive Education Center. A major part of my job has always been figuring out what works and what doesn't. Several years ago, however, the great disparity between the track records of the corporate winners and losers prompted me to step back and specifically tackle the broader question. Why do some companies succeed while others fail? The answer I've come up with is that winning companies win because they have good leaders who nurture the development of other leaders at all levels of the organization. The ultimate test of success for an organization is not whether it can win today, but whether it can keep winning tomorrow and the day after. Therefore, the ultimate test for a leader is not whether he or she makes smart decisions and takes decisive action, but whether he or she teaches others to be leaders and builds an organization that can sustain its success even when he or she is not around. The key ability of winning organizations and winning leaders is creating leaders. The winning organizations and the people who do this well come in all shapes, sizes, and nationalities, and can be found in any industry. The goods and services they produce and the strategies and tactics they employ are widely divergent, but they all share a set of fundamentals. First, leaders with a proven track record of success take direct responsibility for the development of other leaders. Second, leaders who develop other leaders have teachable points of view in the specific areas of ideas, values, and something that I call E-cubed, emotional energy and edge. Winning leaders and/or teachers have ideas that they can articulate and teach to others about both how to make the organization successful in the marketplace and how to develop other leaders. Third, leaders embody their teachable points of view in living stories. They tell stories about their past that explain their learning experiences and their beliefs. And they create stories about the future of their organizations that engage others, both emotionally and intellectually, to attain the winning future that they describe. Finally, because winning leaders invest considerable time developing other leaders, they have well-defined methodologies and coaching and teaching techniques. Among these is the willingness to admit mistakes and show their vulnerabilities in order to serve as effective role models for others. In this tape, I'm going to take you to visit a number of winning leaders so that you can observe them in their roles as leaders and/or teachers, developing other leaders and/or teachers. Among them will be such well-known executives as Jack Welch, CEO of General Electric, Bill Pollard of ServiceMaster, Roger Enrico of PepsiCo, Larry Bossidy of Allied Signal, and Eckert Pfeiffer of Compaq Computer. Teaching is a way of life for them. In Santa Clara, California, Andy Grove, CEO of Intel Corporation, goes into the classroom many times a year to teach Intel managers how to lead in an industry in which the product, microprocessors, doubles in capacity every 18 months. Why does Grove take the time to do this? Because he believes that having leaders at all levels of Intel who can spot the trends and have the courage to act will enable Intel to prosper while competitors falter. If you show up on the right day every couple of weeks at GE's Crotonville Leadership Development Institute, you will find Jack Welch, CEO of GE Teaching. Welch spends an enormous amount of time giving speeches to employees and taking the hot seat in question and answer sessions. But he also interactively teaches. He has a variety of modules, usually half day at a time, that he uses to teach leadership. In addition to holding formal teaching sessions, winning leaders also integrate their leadership development and coaching into the fabric of everyday activities. Dick Stonecipher ran GE Appliances for 5 years until he retired in 1996. During that time, his business produced many officers of GE for other businesses. Stonecipher's point of view on developing leadership is straightforward. You have to work at it, and you can always get better. So he had a policy of giving his executives real-time coaching. After every major meeting, he would go back to them to specifically discuss the things that they had done well and the things they could do better. To improve himself, he also used to carry around a list of things he needed to work on. I use the term winning companies and losing companies to denote the disastrous results that some companies have turned in while other companies, subject to the same global and market trends, prospered. I have no crystal ball and cannot predict with 100% certainty which companies will win in the future, nor can I guarantee that the winning companies I have studied will be winners in the future. I do believe, however, that right now each of them has found the key to sustained success. I would be willing to wager that the companies I will tell you about will be successful for a long time. This is because, as you will see, they have developed into organizations with a leadership engine, where leaders exist at all levels, and leaders actively develop the next generation of leaders. Once this engine gets running, it is hard for competitors to stop. I have a very simple thesis. All people have untapped leadership potential, just as all people have untapped athletic potential. There are clear differences due to nature and nurture, that is, genes and development, as to how much untapped potential there may be. But no matter what level of athletic or leadership performance a person currently exhibits, he or she can make quantum improvements. Not everyone can be the CEO of a multi-billion dollar corporation, just as not everyone can be an Olympian or win at Wimbledon. But with coaching and practice, we can all be a lot better than we are. The important teaching point is, leadership is there in you. I have a little exercise that helps people see this. First, I ask them to review their lives and think about a leadership success that they have enjoyed. I've tried this with literally thousands of executives and MBA students worldwide, and I am fully convinced that almost everyone has had such an experience. At some time in high school or college, at work or on an athletic team, or in a community or church group, they have made something happen through other people that would never have occurred without their leadership. Once participants have a clear picture in their mind of the time in their lives when they were most proud of themselves as a leader, I ask them to tell the story to someone else. Inevitably, the room ignites with energy as the partners share their leadership stories. People love to tell their stories. After a few minutes, I ask the group to stand back from the stories and reflect on what made the leadership successful. Then, as a group, we generate a list of the characteristics of effective leadership built on what I call their personal benchmarking trip. As they articulate the important qualities of leadership, people realize that they know about winning leadership. Many, to their dismay, also realize that they haven't really exercised it in years. It is never too early or too late to take on the challenge of improving your leadership abilities and of developing them in others. The scarcest resource in the world today is leadership talent capable of continuously transforming organizations to win in tomorrow's world. The individuals and organizations that build leadership engines and that invest in leaders developing other leaders have a sustainable competitive advantage. In August 1991, Bill Weiss, the CEO of Ameritech, walked into my office with a problem. The company he headed was an old-style Baby Bell telephone operating company that suddenly found itself having to compete in a new, fast-moving telecommunications industry. In order to survive, it needed to expand its product mix, change its bureaucratic operating style, and establish a new working culture based on intense competition rather than stifling regulation. After listening to Weiss describe the situation at Ameritech, my colleague Patricia Stacy and I came to a clear conclusion. Bill, I told him, you are 62 years old and retiring at 65. I don't think we should be talking about you leading any kind of transformation. Your agenda is to find a successor, make sure he or she is in place, and get out of the way. You'll have to turn it over to that person to do the transformation. Weiss was polite but firm. I can't do that, he replied. We'll lose 2 or 3 more years while that person is getting his or her act together. That would be catastrophic because within 5 years, we've got either to transform this company or find our markets rapidly shrinking. We've got to find a way to radically reform and reorient our company. We'll have to deal with succession in that context. Within 6 months of this meeting, 2 of the key potential CEO successors had left Ameritech, and 4 new potential successors from within the organization were leading a massive cultural change effort called Breakthrough Leadership. It involved hundreds of leaders and task forces and intensive development activities throughout 1992. In 1993, this was expanded to thousands of Ameritech managers. By May 1994, when Weiss retired, the company had been totally reorganized into new business units, and a new CEO was in place, 47-year-old Dick Notabart. It had thousands of re-energized and motivated employees, and it was primed to take off in the new telecommunications world. From 1993 through 1996, Ameritech outperformed its peers. For 1996, Ameritech posted net income of $2.13 billion on revenues of $14.9 billion. Winning is about leadership.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.